call. That was a wonderful, wholesome answer which I got for a very half-liner question. And it really covers a lot. But I wanted three things which I felt are important in today's world when you're shipbuilding. You're not building the platform alone. So you have equipment you're going to put into it, then weaponization, and the third point, the export market. So what would you like to tell us about it?
I think on equipment and systems, the major platform which I indigenously designed and built, since we began our journey in designing and building them, it dates back to 1986-87. You are now just asking me to get into the history. So that's the time we started doing our absolute first equipment from fundamental design and development. So from a concept of that equipment onwards, and Navy was someone who was open, having started the naval design, I would say in the mid-60s, actually involved us right in the very early stages. I leave out some small thing that we must have done. Quite significantly from mid-80s, we've been taking on those considered impossible to be built kind of equipment, and they all have been built in the country. Having built a track record, as I said, about 70% of the total fleet between Coast Guard and Navy, Larsen & Toubro exists on those fleets, and we then obviously, instead of just doing the fundamental R&D product development and then making the equipment, delivering, assisting them, whosoever is the shipyard, including the government shipyards, assisting in installation, commissioning it in full sense. Thereafter, we actually are supporting all our equipment in terms of a life cycle. So as a responsible company, we believe that we just can't make equipment and give it and not support it for next 20, 25, 30 years while Navy operates it. We made some basic fundamental differences to the way Navy would work. Electronics, it is known in the past that every 7-8 years used to get into obsolescence, and this needed a replacement, and a huge amount of revenue cost out of this was to the Navy. Late 90s, we actually changed it to the open architecture standards. And let me say, we are business entities. I run a business, but I don't make big money on my life support, which any foreign company would make a dramatic amount of money on, you know, supporting. It's said that if you spend 100 rupees on buying a vessel, you spend 350 to 400 on life cycle. I don't trust any of those numbers. The orders I got in last 25 years of all my equipment operating and thousands of them operating across the naval and the Coast Guard fleet, we don't even do few crores a year. Idea essentially is when you make a new standardization, which is based on open architecture, your previous equipment compatibility to the new generation is so high that Navy actually doesn't have to spend money. It's just the hardware. It's not the soft and the knowledge which you charge for. As a result, the cost of maintenance and cost of upkeeping is a fraction and a single digit fraction, rather than talking of big money which they have been paying to all the foreigners in the past. So that's one major contribution which out of the equipment system that we did. Having built some amazing equipment, Larsen & Toubro leveraged its DRDO relationship to get into huge number of weapon systems development in the country. For various reasons, Government of India till literally, even till today, given exception of recent some MGO RFPs on physical armament was never allowed for private sector to get in for historic reasons. Without the armament, when we look at the weapon systems as such, today, India imports only one weapon system. And all of us know it's an LRSAM, which is whatever is coming, joint development program between Israelis and DRDO. But all other weapon systems today are designed and built in the country. We started this journey in the mid-90s, and every weapon system that point on, which has been indigenously designed and built, is operational on the warships. And we are proud partners to Navy on that. Equipment system, yes, all of those we've been doing, but it's also on the weapons. And that's exactly where I say that one basic change between the last seminar and this seminar, you see Navy top brass also talking of from on the fight, It used to be 35, 40. Today you hear people saying it's 60 and above. So that's a class difference we are talking. The latest of the major frigates and frigate and destroyer programs, if one looks at, there are more than 36 equipment and systems which Larsen & Toubro delivers. So that's the range and depth we built. Now, where does it take us? There are at least about 10 or 12 countries where we are selling today the equipment. It's like we started doing equipment and weapons in the Indian Navy. That later days leveraged to getting into the major platform programs. Similar is the story which we see building on the export markets. We actually have been selling from 2002 some small equipment. They're today operational with at least 10 different countries and their naval fleets. Now from that point on, we today have started delivering completely integrated weapon suites. So if there's someone today who wants that, I have a ship, an older one, getting into obsolescence, would you give me a complete ASW suite? And we actually have created the PPP. During my speech today, I said the game is collaboration. So we have a PSU partner. With PSU partner, we have got into major contracts. He supplies the weapon. I supply the weapon system, fire controls, and the whole ship integration. So this is exactly we see that on equipment systems, including weapons, today are getting sold out. There's a dramatic change in the export scenario as I see. Now, besides that, we have just about one major win on the platforms. The warships getting physically built for another country. And we were very responsible in that we believed that when Government of India was providing that kind of a specific aid package, and this country had an aspiration that please give me that, but I don't want all of them imported. So we said, okay, half of them we deliver from India, half of them we assist building it right in your country with whosoever you decide. So there's a small shipyard there. Obviously, it doesn't have the kind of skill sets what one has built in Larsen & Toubro, and of the systems to actually make it. Because to do a OPV class from the day you lay your keel to do a delivery of a warship in 16 months has not happened in this country. It happened here. The first of class delivered ahead of contractual schedule has not happened in this country. Some of the other OPVs, there were more than 30-35 OPVs which have been built in India by various shipyards, but probably 17-18 ships started going on time. Larsen & Toubro's first OPV was ahead of schedule. So, ability to do this is something which is being valued by some of those foreign navies, and they are asking us today, yes, part you supply, part you come, handhold, supply the equipment package, and let's build it there. So that's essentially where we see the exports growing. Many more opportunities in pipeline, but Larsen & Toubro doesn't really talk far too much before we make things happen. On weapons, large number of contracts and orders on naval side. If tomorrow someone says, I want a surface-to-surface warfare, we can deliver a full package because there's so much which has been done by our own Navy. Idea essentially is we build certain great skill sets, and not, I won't take the entire credit for this. Navy and the professional directorates of Navy have been extremely supportive of this. They are the ones who have been saying, okay, if we need to do it, tell me what is that you want. And rest is history that we've been a good company performing. Navy obviously has been someone. One obvious constraint they have is they may love me, they may like me, but they can't place orders just because I perform. So there's obviously a competition, and one has to win in a competitive kind of a mode. Once you win a competitive and do a new development, Navy has been fair that they have stayed. Everybody else in MOD and other places today talks of long-term relationships. If I talk of long-term relationships with Navy, they run in some of my programs more than 20 years, more than 25 years, and one is actually doing it. If there is a good performing company, and that's essentially where I think our example proves it out, that if you are performing well, if you are delivering, even if you make losses on your early orders, it's fine because initial development and business at that time doesn't make sense because development is far more expensive. But when your customer stays with you at a later date, you make up for those losses. And that's exactly how one has looked at. So we are someone who is investors, not only in infrastructure in terms of development cost, and we see a partnership from the Navy that they would like to carry forward those kind of relationships, and that's essentially where we see future is amazing, lot of level playing field issues actually addressed, few as I said do remain, and as I see actually one another difference in the whole of MOD today, those issues if you voice, there's somebody who is willing to listen, say okay, let's articulate it well, if it is systemic, we'll try and address it. Nobody can promise you 100% issues will get solved, but bulk of them are getting addressed. So obviously with that, one looks forward to the future unfolding in a big way. Lot of exports I see in pipeline, so that when we have ability to pay up to a certain amount of money, making all programs competitive, the same budget of Navy, they can grow more in terms of physically buying more. Second, more and more exports will happen, and government is today far more willing to clear export clearances. They come on time. You could simply call up and say, I have a case, and things happen. In principle, that you go ahead happens very, very quickly. Paperwork may take some amount of time. Bulk of it today is electronic, but notwithstanding, you want a certain specific support from government, approach Ministry of Defense and they are willing to do that. Your DAs, ambassadors in those countries willing to support, handhold you. So we see an era which is actually opening up far more, trying to take the private sector in its fold. Some small issues remain. I think that's where the beautiful girl is always known for that little black dot. So that's exactly how one sees. That black dot makes it far more challenging, and that's essentially we see future. Thank you.